So, Steve, would you open the meeting with prayer, please, sir?
Thank you, Father, for this technology that allows us to see and talk in real time with each other and from all over the country, maybe all over the world. I don't know where all the people are calling from or joining us from, but I pray for your Holy Spirit to reveal truth to us, to open our understanding, that we'll understand the scriptures, that Jesus will be glorified and that truth will be known, and where perhaps we aren't able to know what the truth is about a subject because it's just not that important. I pray that we'll have the right attitude about those things too and not be over curious about that which is not ours to know. But we do pray for the learning of everyone here in a better knowledge of your word and of who Jesus is, and especially what he wants us to do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to talk to Boyd Griffin, first of all. Boyd's a regular participant with us. Boyd, go ahead and activate your mic, and we'll talk to you.
First question I have is, when Moses sprinkled the blood in Hebrews 9:19, it says that he sprinkled both the book itself and all the people. What book was that?
This was the book, it was probably not only the stone tablets, but also the book, what's called the Book of the Covenant. That book, the contents of that are found in chapters 21, 22, and 23 of Exodus. So right after you have the Ten Commandments, God also gives three chapters of instructions, which is referred to as the Book of the Covenant. Almost certainly that's the book that was sprinkled along with the people.
And the second question I have is that Jesus had preached in Galilee and Samaria. When did the church come to those regions?
That's a really good question. Of course, we know that Philip went up there and evangelized in a city of Samaria in Acts chapter 8. It may be that from that beachhead, the rest of Samaria got evangelized, because lots of times when a church was established in an area, you know, they would send out missionaries to their region to reach others around them. But we don't know. I mean, we also don't know very much about when the various regions of Galilee were evangelized, because in the book of Acts, we read about the church in Jerusalem primarily. But we do have the commission of Jesus given in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, that they should preach in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. We have to believe there were a lot of people in Galilee who must have become part of churches in their areas after Pentecost, but we don't read of who evangelized them there. We have very limited record of areas that were evangelized. We have mostly, of course, record of Philip's activity, Peter's activity, and Paul's activity. But we're also told in Acts chapter 11 that when Stephen was stoned to death, a lot of people from Jerusalem were scattered, and probably many of them in a northern way through Samaria. We know that Philip was one of those who went that direction. And probably a lot of them went to Galilee too. And it says they preached the gospel everywhere. So we have to assume that, though we aren't given specific records of specific places, the places where Jesus had ministered most in Galilee during his ministry, probably there were probably a lot of people converted there after Pentecost, but we don't know who evangelized them. It's mainly unnamed missionaries who scattered from Jerusalem when persecution arose.
Thank you.
Okay, Boyd, good talking to you, man. Thank you. All right. Next we have Ben.
Hi there.
Hi.
So I have a question. It's something I've been thinking about for quite some time. So in the church I go to, this happened like a year ago, they like excommunicated somebody, and they did it. It was just like the pastor just decided it, right? And when I look into the Bible, it seems like that is a decision for the church to make. And when I talked to my friend about it, he said, well, church means like pastor and leaders. But then when I looked into the word, it doesn't seem like it means that. Like,
no, it doesn't.
You have word. Yeah. You have words like company, right? Like if I go talk to like Apple, I could say I talk to the company if I talk to the leader of it, because the word implies like some kind of organization to it. But the word church to me seems like it's just an assembly. So if I talk to the assembly, you know, in normal English, you would have to get up and talk to the whole group. Like, right. Am I wrong, or like, what do you think?
Oh, no, you're right. I think in modern times, the word church has taken on a corporate, like corporation kind of a tone to it, like Apple. Like if you want to talk to Apple, you go and talk to the leaders of Apple, because they are the decision makers for Apple and so forth. And because churches have taken on a corporation sort of identity, the leaders of them often think of themselves as CEOs and, you know, board of directors and so forth of the corporation. And so they naturally think, you know, if someone needs to present to the church, they bring it to us, the elders or the pastors. Jesus didn't assume that. Jesus never assumed that the churches would take on a American corporate structure. You know, that his idea was it was a family. The church was a family of people. And there were people who provided guidance, but they were the older men who had, you know, sterling reputations in the church and who provided an example and teaching to the church, but they weren't bosses. They were family members. And that's why Jesus told the apostles in Matthew, he said, don't let anyone call you teacher or rabbi or anything like that. He says, you're all brothers. You know, you have one teacher, Christ, and you're all brothers. So this whole idea that the elders have thought of themselves now as the bosses comes from the idea that the church is now seen as a corporation rather than as a family. And, you know, it's interesting. The Church of Corinth is one of the few churches we read about where an actual act of excommunication was done. Now, Jesus, of course, taught about excommunication in Matthew 18, verses 15 through 17, and Paul referred to or alluded to excommunication in Romans 16, 20, I think it is, and also in Titus chapter 3, around verse 10. It talks about, you know, disfellowshipping people. Also 2 Thessalonians 3, I think it's around verses 11 through 13, if I'm right about that. But there are several times that Jesus or Paul instructs that people of a certain type, after a certain process, should be cut off from the fellowship. But the only case we actually have a record of it actually happening is Corinth. And interestingly enough, we have no evidence that Corinth even had official leadership. It's one of the few churches that Paul writes to, and he doesn't mention anything about the leaders. He does mention leaders of Thessalonians. He does mention the bishops or the overseers of the Philippians in Philippians 1:1. But he doesn't mention any leaders in either 1st or 2nd Corinthians. And it's amazing, too, because those two are the churches that he wrote the most to. He wrote more to the Corinthians than to really anyone else. And he doesn't ever mention leaders, even though he deals with problems in the church, disunity in the church, sin in the church, you know, bad decorum in the church, you know, women not covering their heads and people not being orderly in their, you know, use of the gifts of the Spirit. But when he talks about excommunication in 1 Corinthians 5, he says, listen, here's my instruction. When the whole church is come together, you guys deliver that person over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so his spirit might be saved in the day of Christ Jesus. So he says, when the church comes together, you guys corporately do this. He doesn't say the leaders do this, as if there's certain leaders who act as the church. And this is this idea that, you know, it all has to be done by leaders has really led to some real, I mean, some abuse. I'm sure that in many cases, having leaders in the church has worked out reasonably well for churches, but I've certainly seen it where the pastors, you know, they make decisions that will benefit them or their organization or their agenda for the church. And in many cases, they don't consult the church at all. So, I mean, that sounds like an example that you've given of a pastor.
Right. And they tell us that we're not supposed to contact this person. And it's just like, well, who are you to tell me who I can talk to You know what I mean? And so it's just like, I don't even want to be there. Like, I don't like going there.
A church did that to me once back in the 70s. You know, they were telling me not to fellowship with a certain person because he was persona non grata at the church, though he'd never been formally excommunicated. It's just the pastor didn't feel good about him. And he told me not to associate with him. I said, well, I'm not going to disfellowship a brother. That's sin, unless he's been excommunicated, you know? And so I got excommunicated.
But what they do is they force this other person to agree not to contact anybody in the church. So even if you want to contact them, they're like afraid because I don't know what's going on. It's just all kind of like
that's
muddy.
That's,
I don't know.
That's abuse. That is abuse because frankly, I mean, the church, if they go through the process that Jesus had to go through, then before anyone has been disfellowshipped, it will have come before the public congregation. The whole church together, and it'll be made clear to them that this person is being removed from fellowship because we've confronted him at these different levels that Jesus said to, and he will not repent, and there's no question about it. He's in sin, and he won't repent. So we're actually formally doing what Jesus said. We're going to consider him as a heathen or a tax collector, and that means we're not going to, as Paul said, not even to eat with such a person. And now, of course, some people in the church might be disobedient, but that's between them and God. I mean, it's not for the elders to tell them what they can or cannot do. I mean, the elders should advise. Go ahead.
How does the church make that decision then? Like, to me, it seems like what Christ is saying is that the final step doesn't happen until the church itself reaches out to this person and tries to get them to repent.
Yeah. Well, I think what it is that if the person has not repented after the first two tries, then he is brought before the church, and the church in agreement, you know, perhaps by saying amen or something, you know, there's someone presides the church usually. I mean, even if they don't have elders, they probably have someone presiding over a meeting in one way or another. And so the case would be presented to the church. The church would presumably agree that the guy has to repent of sin and that he's failed to do so. And then from that point on, it's understood that the church has ruled on the situation and that the people in the church should not be in contact with that person deliberately. Now, Paul says in 2 Thessalonians 3, when there's certain people who don't abide by the word of this epistle, he says, have no company with them. But he said, don't treat them as an enemy, but admonish them as a brother. Admonish means warn them, and that means, you know, you can't do that unless you communicate with them. But I think that would suggest that if you encounter them, you know, I mean, after all, they all live in the same town. And so, I mean, you don't think of them as an enemy, but if you have occasion to speak to him, maybe he calls you and wants to get together with you, or you run into him somewhere, you say, no, this has already been decided, you know, by the agreement of the body, you need to repent. And that's, you know, that's the only kind of, you know, fellowship, I think, that is appropriate at that point. Now, I will say I got an email, I think today or yesterday, from someone who said that he got kicked out of a church by the pastor because he didn't believe in the pre-trib rapture. Now, you know, if he was causing divisions in the church over it, this is a disciplinable offense. I mean, causing divisions is not right, but just believing something different than what the pastor believes is not itself divisive. If the pastor says you can't believe differently than me, or else I'm kicking you out, then the pastor's the one being divisive, not the person who has a difference of opinion. There's no law against having your own opinion about certain things. But church discipline was to be exercised against people who are committing sins, as Jesus said in Matthew 18, 15, if your brother sins against you, confront him. If he repents, great. If he doesn't, bring two more. If he doesn't repent, then take it before the church. It's about unrepented sin. Likewise, when Paul said to excommunicate the guy who is living with his father's mother in 1 Corinthians 5, that's a sin. It's not that the man had a wrong opinion about something that Christians can differ about.
Right.
It's that he was in rebellion against the standards of obedience to Christ. So, I mean, it's a world of difference. Almost all people I have known who have been excommunicated from churches, including myself at various times, unfortunately, they were excommunicated over having a difference of opinion, not over sin. I've never been excommunicated for sin. And I've never, I have on occasion, rare occasion, seen someone excommunicated because of sin, but usually it's because the pastor is uncomfortable with their beliefs.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah, the pastor doesn't own the church, though. That's what the church needs to realize that. He's not the CEO. Yeah. He's not the owner. He's not the manager. He's not the boss. He doesn't own the church. He's a slave. Whoever will be chief among you should be the slave of all, Jesus said. And in any sense which he begins to act like they're his slaves and they're supposed to obey him, that's where he's shows himself to be a Diotrephes. We have, of course, in 3 John, John mentioned this man, Diotrephes, who was a fake leader who put himself up and loved to have the preeminence and wouldn't let people disagree with him and so forth. That's what many pastors today, unfortunately, have become. And the churches should not.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. God bless you, Ben. Good talking to you, man. Okay. Mike Lucero. Good to see you.
Thanks, Steve.
Hey, brother.
Good to see you. So I'm reading this book, The Gospel of the Kingdom, Philip Morrow, and I actually heard a guy on your show say something about it. So I bought the book.
Yeah.
And I actually found something in there that I hadn't heard before, and I wanted to hear your comments about it. So he said, and I verified this in my Scofield Bible, I still have one. It said, dispensationalists say that the law was not imposed until it was proposed and accepted at Sinai. They exchanged grace for law and rashly accepted the law. Morrow says, by saying they acted rashly, that God acted unfairly toward them and took advantage of their ignorance of what it meant to be under the law, thus leading them into a deadly trap they couldn't get out of. Wasn't the law? That was part of God's plan. That's what separated them from everything else. So have you heard that before? I mean, I know you read the book.
You know, you found that in the Scofield after Morrow.
Yeah, I verified what he said.
You know, I used the Scofield Bible for many years at the beginning of my ministry when I was a dispensationalist. In fact, I wore the covers off of 4 in a row. I mean, I just used them so much. But I didn't read all the notes. I don't remember that specific point being made. Probably it was in Exodus where the notes found.
That was Exodus 19.
Yeah. I didn't remember. Of course, that's been, it could be 50 years ago now. That since I've been using the Scofield, I haven't used it in that long, so I didn't remember that particular point. But it is certainly wrong. I mean, to suggest that it was a rash thing for the Israelites to say yes when God said, "This is my covenant. You want to be my wife?" You know, for them to accept that proposal was not rash. That was what are they supposed to say? No, no, yeah. God. You know, I mean, what God said is, "I am the Lord who brought you out of Egypt on eagle's wings and delivered you and brought you to this place." And I want you to be my people. And if you obey my covenant, keep my word, then you'll be my special people and I'll treat you specially and so forth. And what Scofield thinks they're supposed to say, no thanks.
You know? Yeah, he said they had to accept it. But I mean, what choice did they have? They were God's people.
Right. Well, they could have rejected it and not ever been used by God in any way. There were individuals who were cut off because they didn't accept those terms. I mean, think of Korah and the group that was swallowed up by the earth world because, by the earth because they rejected God's appointed leader, Moses and Aaron. So, I mean, it was always possible for an Israelite to say, "No, I'm not agreeing to this covenant." But then they'd be, the Bible says, cut off from the people. They wouldn't be able to still be part of the nation of Israel. The covenant was made with the obedient, and the conditions for participation were obedience. As he said in Exodus 19:5, if you obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, you'll be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine, he said, and a kingdom of priests and so forth. So, you know, obedience, of course, was required, but it's required to us too. Jesus said, whoever, you know, continues in my words is my disciple. Why do you say, call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do what I say? He said, go and make disciples, teach them to observe everything I've commanded you. I mean, obviously, the new covenant requires obedience too. Scofield apparently didn't believe that. Different dispensations think somewhat differently about obedience. Many of them don't feel like obedience is required under the new covenant. It's just something that we might, if we feel, you know, particularly grateful to God for his grace, we might obey him. But that obedience is really kind of optional because we're saved by grace, not by works. So they understand works to be synonymous with obedience. Where when Paul says we're not saved by works, he's speaking specifically of the works of the ritual law. He's talking about circumcision, kosher diet, festival observance, things like that. It's very clear in the context where he says those things. He's talking about not works of obedience to Jesus. He's not dissing those. He's just saying the works of the law that distinguish the Jews from Gentiles, namely the laws of cleanness and those kinds of things. Those works don't commend them to God. We're not saved by being Jews. We're saved by faith, but Paul did say in Galatians 5:6, it's a faith that works through love. Well, okay, so works are necessary. But if you have that faith, it is a faith that works through love. If it doesn't work, it's not the faith that Paul's talking about that saves.
Yeah. Can I ask you one other thing real briefly? I don't think I've heard anybody ask you on your radio show recently about the whole conflict with Alistair Begg and the recommendation he made. Are you familiar with that?
You know, somebody just asked me that yesterday.
Oh, okay. I didn't hear yesterday's show, actually.
And, you know, I had heard some kind of vague rumblings about it a few days earlier, but no one asked me about it, and I didn't know what it was about. I heard that there's some issue with Alistair Begg. And then someone called me yesterday and asked what I thought about it, and I said, well, I haven't really heard what it is. And he told me, and I thought, Apparently what happened is Alistair Begg was asked by a woman whether she should attend the wedding of probably, a relative of hers, a granddaughter or something, who's a transsexual, right? And Alistair Begg told her to attend it and bring a gift. Now, apparently a lot of people, including John MacArthur, and I'm not surprised that he would be among those who would have, you know, condemned Alistair Begg for making that recommendation. And so that's become, I guess, he's become a lightning rod for a lot of criticism about that. What I said on the air, I'll say more briefly right now. And that is that, of course, I would not personally recommend that anyone go to a wedding that you cannot approve of. So same-sex couple, transsexuals, even, frankly, even a Christian who's rebelliously marrying a non-Christian. You know, when you go to a wedding, you're not just going to a spectator event where you reserve judgment about it and you're just there in a non-judgmental way. You're there to witness of, you know, sacred vows being made and to become one who is then accepting the responsibility of holding them to those vows if they ever should be inclined to break them. Now, if you can't approve of the vow in the first place, you certainly can't celebrate it, and you certainly can't ask them to keep them because the vows themselves are sinful. So it's really hard. It's a hard, hard thing. So I, at least that's what I understand attending a wedding to mean. Now, I realize that not everyone sees it that way. For some people, it's just a spectator thing. You know, I'm just going, you know, something's happening. Everybody's going to see it. I'm going to go watch it too. I mean, that's, to me, I take marriage more seriously than that. I consider it very sacred. I consider it to be very covenantal, and I think that the witnesses should be those of the family, both the natural family if possible and the family of faith, who are hearing the vows to be witnesses, and as witnesses going to hold them to it. And of course, that being the way I see things, I would never recommend that someone go to a wedding that we can't approve of. Now, on the other hand, there's another way of seeing it. It's not persuasive to me, but I'm in some circumstances, maybe I could be persuaded. I'm not at this point, but, you know, Christians are viewed as haters and, you know, homophobes and transphobes and stuff like that. And Alistair Begg may have felt that it would glorify God more for a Christian grandmother to seem gracious and welcoming and forgiving, even if she, especially, honestly, if she had already registered her disagreement with it, then Alistair Begg might have assumed that, okay, she's already said she doesn't agree, so her coming there is not going to communicate something that it isn't. You know, she just, you know, she's not going to treat them like lepers. It's a loving, accepting kind of thing to do. I certainly have heard the arguments on both sides, and I'm not saying that both sides don't have a case to be made. I'm just saying I would have given different advice than Alistair Begg made, but I don't judge him for for what he said, because the Bible doesn't really tell us whether to go to a wedding or not. You know, going to weddings is something the Bible just doesn't discuss. So the real issue is, what do you mean by going to a wedding? What do you understand that to be communicating? If it seems to be communicating approval of and celebration of what's going on, then of course you can't go to a wedding like that. If it's just something where nobody thinks of it that way at all, it's just, you know, an event. Who knows? Maybe you wouldn't be, and you've already clarified to them that you don't approve. I'm not going to be harsh on somebody who makes a different decision than me. The fact that anyone would criticize Beg for that, it just strikes me as more petty than it should be. You know,
exactly what you said, Steve. I heard him talk about it, and I heard him preach about it too. The grandmother's grandchild knew how she felt.
Yeah.
And, you know, his advice to her was basically so there wasn't more division and more reason for them to feel the way a lot of people do about Christians, thinking that they're haters and stuff. So
I assumed
well intentioned.
I never heard Alistair ever give his side, but I just assumed as much. I assumed that was his reasoning. But, and you know, it's not the advice I would have given, I don't think. At least as I sit here today, you know, thinking about somebody else's situation, I think, no, I don't think I'd agree with that. But it'd be very, I would feel very wrong to judge another man about what he felt was wise or good at the situation. I might say, hey, we don't agree about that. But I don't think the pastor Beg is doing something immoral himself, or even that the grandmother is necessarily doing something immoral. The real question I would have is, what message are you sending? That'd be the main issue for me.
Yeah. It's hard to see people get so hard on him. And I mean, people should know, you know, where his heart is. He's been preaching for years. He's a good teacher.
That's it. Alistair Begg has a great track record, you know, of being a great pastor, a great evangelical. I disagree with his Calvinism and some other things, but he's a great man, I assume. I mean, I don't know him personally, but his ministry has been fruitful, and he's kept his nose clean. I don't think he's involved in any scandals himself. And, you know, if someone's like, oh, I don't agree with the counsel he gave, just like I said, you know, okay, point registered, you know, you don't agree. That's okay. Now let's go on. Let's move on. You know, unless you can find a verse in the Bible that commands a man never to advise someone to go to a wedding between two sinners, then you can't judge Alistair for having a different opinion about that.
Yeah. Well, because he wouldn't recant, they took him off American Family Radio. And I mean, there's been some fallout from it. So it's just kind of.
I'm sorry to hear that. Yeah.
Thanks, brother.
Okay, Mike. Good talking to you, man.
You too.
All right. Bye now. All right, Jacob, activate your mic if it isn't already, and we'll talk to you.
All right. How are you doing?
Good. Good to see you again.
Yeah, you too. My question has to do with the second Exodus. Can you explain the terminology?
Well, the Bible doesn't use the term second Exodus, but there are passages that do recall the Exodus when they're looking forward to what we would call a second Exodus, because it's not referring to the original. For example, when on the Mount of Transfiguration in Luke chapter 9, Moses and Elijah appeared to Jesus and were talking to him. It says in the Greek, they were talking to him about the Exodus that he was going to accomplish in Jerusalem, meaning he's going to save his people through his death and resurrection. And of course, Moses had been the leader of the original Exodus, and here he is now talking to Jesus about the Exodus that Jesus is going to accomplish. So it's obviously not the same Exodus, because that was accomplished 1400 years earlier. Let's talk about a second one. Now in Isaiah 11, of course, it talks about God bringing his people to their land from all lands. And he says, as it was in the day when he brought them out of Egypt. Now, in other words, as it was in the Exodus, something else is going to happen that's analogous to that. It's not going to be literally a replay of the old Exodus, but there's a comparison with the old Exodus. And in my opinion, now this is one of the things that are controversial. Some people think that passages like Isaiah 11, which is one of the kingdom passages in Isaiah, they would apply those to the millennium in the future. My understanding is, especially from the number of times that passage is quoted in the New Testament, that they apply it to the the present age. The Exodus is our exodus out of sin into Christ, into salvation. And that's how I understand it. That the first Exodus was a type, and the second one is the antitype. That's the idea. All right, Dale?
Can you hear me?
There you go. I can hear you now, yes.
Oh, sorry about that. I'm here with my wife, Petey, and great to be on this venue. Appreciate it. And we're calling from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And my question had to do with the promise of God to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob concerning the land of Canaan.
Mm-hmm.
And the basic question is whether those promises made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were conditional or were they unconditional? And if I could just read one of them or a couple of them. And I have some verses noted from Genesis 12 through Genesis 28. Genesis 12:7 says that the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your descendants, I will give this land." And then chapter 13, the Lord said to Abraham, after Lot had separated from him, God says, "For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. Arise, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you." And there are other repetitions of this to Abraham as well as to Isaac and Jacob about God giving their descendants all these lands.
Right.
So in those passages, it sure seems to be unconditional. But I guess the question is: Is there something else in Scripture that would clearly show us that no, they were conditional, and Israel didn't meet those conditions, etc.?
Yes, there is. Now you say they seem to be unconditional, and of course they seem that way because they don't mention in those passages any conditions. And so the absence of any mention of conditions makes it seem unconditional, unless he has said the same things and given the same promises elsewhere with conditions attached. Then it should not be necessary for him to restate the conditions every single time. So God promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that he would give that land of Canaan to their descendants. Did he do so? Well, first of all, he did. We know that's true because it says so in Joshua chapter 21. This is after the end of the conquests that Joshua led Israel in. In Joshua 21, 43 through 45, it says, "So the Lord gave to Israel all the land of which he had sworn to give to their fathers." The fathers being Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So God gave Israel all the land that he had sworn to give to their fathers, and they took possession of it and dwelt in it. That pretty much fulfills that promise. The Lord gave them rest all around according to all that he had sworn to their fathers. And not a man of all their enemies stood against them. The Lord delivered all their enemies into their hand. Not a word failed of any good thing which the Lord had spoken to the house of Israel. All came to pass. Now, I mean, that's a pretty strong statement. Now, how would anyone then say, well, no, God didn't give them the land? Now, dispensationalists actually do say that God didn't give them the land. And what they say is, well, when you come to the book of Judges, at the beginning of the book of Judges, we read, there were still some cities that weren't conquered. The Canaanites still were in Jerusalem. They were still in this city and in that city and so forth that hadn't been overthrown. And these people had iron chariots, so Israel wasn't able to drive them out. Now they dwell in these lands in their own arms, you know, walled cities. Well, okay, somehow those facts have to be agreeable with what Joshua said, or else Joshua lied, which is not right. To my mind, to say that, and I don't mean this in a politically incorrect way or anything like that, but if we were to say, you know, God gave the Europeans this portion of North America, they had to fight the Indians, but the Indians were defeated and the Europeans took control of the land. I mean, we don't have to say God did that, but I mean, the point is, it's entirely possible and truthful to say that the Europeans now occupy this part of the land. The former Europeans took it over. Now, does that mean there are no places where Indians still dwell? No, we've got, you know, they're on reservations and so forth, but they live under the laws of America. They are still some remnants of the original inhabitants, and some of them are mixed in our society, and some are off on reservations where if they prefer. But the fact that many Indian tribes still exist in North America doesn't mean that this portion of North America has not been conquered and occupied and inhabited by those who came from Europe. Okay, so to say that Israel conquered the land doesn't mean that they didn't, maybe wrongfully, allow some pockets of the original inhabitants to live in their own cities, kind of insulated from Israel's society in general, but unable to drive Israel out. I mean, Israel definitely owned the territory. That would be a reasonable way to see that Joshua is correct and Judges are correct. But one thing that seems very unreasonable for any evangelical who believes the Bible's inspired to say would be that they didn't conquer the land. They didn't dwell in all the land, because, I mean, it's emphatic. God gave them all the land. They occupied it. They dwelt in it. Not one promise of his failed to come true, it says. So, you actually don't have any statement in Scripture that says Israel did not conquer the land. But you have this one, at least, that says they did. And so I'm going to go with what the Bible says and not affirm something that the Bible does not say. Now, what about permanently? Because, he said, I'm giving it to you forever. Now, here's the thing about the word forever. And I think we naturally kind of rebel against this, but it's a fact. You can look it up for yourself. The word forever or eternal or everlasting, these words are all translations of a Hebrew word, olam, O-L-A-M, olam. It is used a lot of different ways in the Old Testament. It can refer to something that has no end, like God, the everlasting God, the olam God. Well, God has no end. And so it can refer to something that has no end, but the word itself doesn't mean having no end. Olam means, it comes from the Hebrew word for hidden. And all the lexicons will say it refers to something that's beyond the horizon, something that continues beyond the point that we can see the end of it. We can't see the end of it. It's over the hill. It's over the horizon. We can't see the end. It may have an end or it might not. It's not saying that it does or does not have an end. It just says we can't see the end from here if there is one. And many times things are said to be olam, like the hills, the everlasting hills, or the everlasting doors of Jerusalem and things like that, that are not literally everlasting, but we have no idea when they'll end. We can't see the end of it from here. And that's the real meaning of everlasting. Now, there's a thing about the way this is used in the Old Testament. Sometimes it is used of things that will last a very long time. And many of the promises of God in the Old Testament and the commands of God in the Old Testament are said to be forever. For example, God told Abram that circumcision was eternal, olam. It's forever for all generations. Keeping the Sabbath was said to be required forever. Keeping Passover was said to be forever. In fact, keeping all the laws was said to be forever. In fact, the oil that was used for the lamps of the tabernacle was an eternal ordinance. But there's no tabernacle now. There's no, these many of these things that are past and don't exist anymore were said to be eternal at the time. Now, there's a couple of ways we can understand that. One is that they do continue in a spiritual form. Circumcision as an ordinance is no longer required, but spiritual circumcision is. So in a sense, circumcision still is required, but of a different sort, a spiritual sort. The priesthood of Aaron was said to be forever. Well, that particular priesthood has passed into a spiritual mode, to a kingdom of priests and Christ, the order of Melchizedek. I mean, one thing is that we could say these things continue, but not in their original form. They were in type form. Now they're in antitype form, or they passed from the ritual to the spiritual form, but they continue. That's one way to look at it, and some Christians explain it that way. Another is simply to say, this is conditional. It's like when you make wedding vows, you say, I'm going to be with you until one of us is dead. But what if that person leaves you? Well, then that changes things. I mean, the assumption is, well, I mean, if you stay with me, if you stay with me, I'm going to stay with you. That's and that's for life. That's forever. There's never going to be a time when I'm going to leave you. That doesn't mean for sure that you won't leave me. That's up to you. But I'm accounting on that when I say this. The idea is I'm expecting you and assuming that you have the same commitment I do, and my commitment is forever. But of course, things can happen to end it, not by me, but by you. You know, it may come to an end. The covenant God made with the people of Israel had everlasting promises to it, but they were conditional. And we know they were conditional. That is, God gave them the land, but keeping the land was definitely conditional. If you look at what he said to them in Numbers chapter 28, which is the classic chapter about what would happen to them if they broke the covenant. In Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 15, God enumerates all the blessings they would have if they keep his covenant. He starts out by saying, in verse 1, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, then the Lord will set you on high above all the nations of the earth. And he talks about all these blessings will overtake you. You know, people invade you one way, but they'll scatter seven ways. You know, there'll be no drought. Your crops will never fail. Your cattle will never miscarry. Your wives will never miscarry. You'll be blessed and protected and no sickness among you. And then he says in verse 15, but, and this is the longer part, this chapter divides into two parts. The parts of what will happen if you're obedient, which is actually verses 1 through 14, and what happens if you're disobedient, which is verses 15 through 68. Yeah, this is a much larger part. And he's very verbose about this. It shall come to pass if you do not obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all his commandments and statutes, which I command you today, that all these curses will come upon you. He goes through all the categories where he said they'd be blessings, but you'll be cursed. You'll be cursing that. You'll be cursing that. You'll be cursed. You'll have miscarriages. Your enemies, your ground will be hard as stone because there'll be no rain. You'll have no crops. Your enemies will come at you, one way, and you shall flee seven ways. And among the things he says to them as conditions for if they break his covenant, you have, for example, this statement in verse 45 and 46. Moreover, all these curses shall come upon you and pursue and overtake you until you are destroyed, because you did not obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which he commanded you, and they shall be upon you for a sign and a wonder and on all your descendants forever. Well, there's a forever too. That's Olam also. So you can be blessed forever. You can have the land forever. You can have God's favor forever. That is if you're obedient. But if you're disobedient, you can have all of his curses forever. And what are those curses? What do those include? Well, one thing it says in verse 63, it shall be that just as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good and to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you and bring you to nothing. And you shall be plucked off from the land which you go to possess. And I'll scatter you among all the people. So he's saying, you obey me, you can stay. This is a promise I'm making forever. You can have this land forever. Assuming, of course, you meet the conditions, obviously. It's like if your uncle hires you to do a job on a trial basis because he's not sure if you're good at it or not, but he finds out you're pretty reliable. He says, well, if you work for 6 weeks and I like what I see, I'll hire you on permanently. You know, and so you do good for 6 weeks and he hires you on permanently. Does this mean you'll never be fired? Well, it depends on how you behave. You know, the assumption you're being hired permanently on the basis of the assumption you're going to keep doing the job diligently and well, as you have been up to this point. If you don't keep it, well, that permanent situation is not going to be so permanent after all, because God doesn't act unilaterally. God acts in relationship, and he makes it very clear. Actually, in 1 Samuel chapter 2, I think it's verse 20, he was talking about the promise he made to the family of Aaron and also of Eli, his ancestors, that they'd be priests permanently, that they'd walk before God, which is an expression meaning be a priest, forever. And look what God says to him at this point. It's actually verse 30. 1 Samuel 2:30, it says, therefore, the Lord God of Israel says, I said indeed that your house, meaning Eli's house, and the house of your father would walk before me forever, that you'd be my priest forever. But now the Lord says, far be it from me, for those who honor me, I will honor, and those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Now he says, I told your ancestors that they would be able to be priests and all their descendants forever. But now I'm telling you this, you have to honor me for that to happen. If you dishonor me, I'm going to not esteem you. If you honor me, I'll honor you. So what God is saying is, I don't always state the conditions, but they should be understood. You know, this, there's no unconditional stuff being promised here. And then one other thing I'll point out to you, chapter 18 of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 7 through 10. The Lord says, the instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to pluck it up, to pull it down, to destroy it, if that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil, I will repent of the disaster which I thought to bring upon it. Now, this is a very, we have a very famous case where this was, this happened, and I think everyone thinks of it immediately. Nineveh. Jonah said, 40 days, Nineveh shall perish. No conditions are stated, but they repented, and God repented of the evil he would do to them. That's what he said he'll always do. If I say I'm going to destroy a nation, well, if they repent from their evil, I'll repent of the evil I said to them. That's just the way I roll. Then he says this in verse 9. The instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to build and to plant it. Okay, do we know of any nations God ever promised to build and plant? Only one I've ever heard of. That was Israel, right? Well, what's he say about them? If that nation does evil in my sight so that it does not obey my voice, then I will repent concerning the good that I said I would benefit it. Now, he doesn't always say the conditions when they exist. He assumes that a sane person would know that such conditions exist. Jonah, the prophet, did not say, in 40 days, Nineveh will perish unless they repent. But there's always that subtext. God says, anytime I say such things, if they repent, I'll repent of it. Anytime I promise to do good for a nation, if they go bad, I'll repent of the good I said. I'm very interactive here, you know? And so we have to understand that when God promised Israel the land forever, there were these conditions. Sometimes they were actually stated. But even if they were never stated, they are to be understood. They're subtext to promises. God doesn't make unconditional promises. Even to Abraham, he didn't make an unconditional promise. He said, leave your father's house and your land and come to a place I'll show, and I will do these things for you. So there was something Abraham had to do. As I understand it, there is, when God says something is forever, there's two ways that it can be forever. One is the natural can continue into the spiritual. That is, it can expand into the small type, can expand into the larger antitype, in which case it continues, but not in the same mode, not the same form. The other thing is that it can be conditional, that if it's, you know, if the conditions are not met that are implied or stated, that forever thing isn't forever anymore. Now, here's the deal. Israel was, they were run out of the land in AD 70 by the Romans because God took it from them and he had the temple destroyed. Why in the world would he do a thing like that? Well, because he'd made a new covenant. And in Hebrews it says where there's a new covenant, that makes the first covenant obsolete. So the covenant God made with, you know, the Israelites at Mount Sinai is no longer, valid because there's a new covenant. And that new covenant didn't promise them any land at all. In fact, it's a spiritual land in a sense. It says in Hebrews chapter 11 that Abram looked for a country whose and a city whose builder and maker is God. He was looking for a spiritual, a heavenly country. So there's a sense in which the land of Canaan was a type of a spiritual and larger inheritance that would come through the Messiah. But back in the Old Testament times, before the Messiah came, God did fulfill that promise. He did give them the land. And then he said they can keep it if they're obedient. But they weren't. They worshiped idols. Eventually, they even crucified the Messiah and rejected him. So, frankly, they lost it. And they lost it for 2,000 years. And there's no suggestion in the Bible that he'd give it back to them. And if he would, it'd certainly have to be on the conditions that they accept him. You know, I mean, they were driven out because of their disobedience. If God were to give it back to them at all, and there's no promise that he would under any conditions give it back to them, because that's an old covenant that's not around anymore. But if it weren't, it would have to require their obedience. And at this point, the Jews in Israel are not obedient to God. They're not even obedient to the Jewish religion, much less to Christ. You know, at least the Pharisees were somewhat obedient to the Jewish religion when God destroyed Jerusalem and gave it to the Romans, but they were judged because they rejected the Messiah. But now the modern Jews, they even reject the Jewish religion. The modern Jews in Israel, less than 20% of them observe Judaism. Most are secular. 75% of the inhabitants of Israel are secular Jews. So, I mean, what is there in Israel today that resembles anything God ever mentioned in the Bible?
Thank you very much. That's very helpful.
Okay, Dale. Hey, you know, if that was like drinking from a fire hose, and you want to pull that again, at my website, there's a series called What Are We to Make of Israel?
Yeah, we've listened to portions of that, and that's good. Okay, yeah. But we need to hear it over and over again.
Yeah, we do. We do. We need to reestablish it in our minds.
Thank you very much.
Well, God bless you both.
Thank you.
Lord bless you.
A pleasure meeting you.
Good meeting you, Steve.
Thank you. All right. Our next participant is Steve Mack. So if you want to activate your mic, there we go. Go ahead, Steve.
Hello, Steve. First time. Thank you. My question revolves around the phrase in the heart of the earth. There's been different ways it's said, you know, he went into the earth to preach the spirits in prison. Some say on the cross it is finished, so he wasn't there. The creed says, you know, he descended for three. So I'm asking, what does it mean the heart of the earth, like Abraham's bosom? But then also, where was, you know, Jesus during that period of those 3 days? Thank you.
Yeah, it's a question that we often have, but which isn't answered specifically in scripture. There are some scriptures that hint at things. But even each one of them, and there's not many of them, but there's a few that hint about such things, or at least some people think they do. But actually, even those are very ambiguous. First of all, when Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today you'll be with me in paradise," there's a bit of a problem here, because on the one hand, in 2 Corinthians 12, in verses 1 through 3, Paul equated paradise with the third heaven. He said he knew a man who was caught up into paradise, into the third heaven, and probably Paul himself he's talking about. But the point there is that paradise then would be equated with heaven. On the other hand, in Jewish thought, paradise was one of the compartments of Sheol, or Hades, where the righteous went to paradise, or Abram's bosom, and the wicked went to another part of Hades. Now, it does say in Acts chapter 2, that Jesus' resurrection fulfilled what David said in Psalm 16, where he said, "You will not leave my soul in Sheol," in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, in Hades, the Greek form. So Peter said, and God didn't leave his soul in Hades because he rose from the dead. So in other words, it suggests he was in Hades. So when he said, "You'll be with me in paradise," does he mean what the Jews thought of as paradise, a part of Hades? Or is he using it the way that Paul used it, who equated it to the third heaven? Obviously, paradise can mean more than one thing, and therefore that's an ambiguous statement. Now, also, Hades or Sheol in certain contexts means the grave. It just means the place where the dead are. Sometimes it means the physical place the dead are. In fact, more often than not, it does. And on occasion, in Jewish thought, they could speak of Hades as the place beyond the grave. But many times that word means the grave. And so when Peter quotes David saying, "You will not leave my soul in Sheol," it's entirely one option that it could be translated, "You will not leave my soul in the grave." And when he says, yeah, Jesus was not left in the grave. He rose from the dead. It might be telling us nothing about your question. You know, your question is, where did Jesus go? Well, I presume we mean, where did his spirit or his soul or his conscious self go? Because we know where his body went. His body went into the grave. Was there something beyond that? It would seem impossible to answer that simply from the statement that his soul was not left in the grave or in Sheol. So there's options. And some people think that he went to heaven. Some people think he went to Hades and into the compartment of Hades, where the righteous would go, Abram's bosom. And, you know, I suppose maybe there'd be room for other views about that since the passages are not clear. Now, there's two passages besides that are sometimes used. One of them you alluded to in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now, there it says in 1 Peter 3:19 that Jesus was put to death in the flesh but made alive through the Spirit. Then after it mentions the Spirit, it says, by which, meaning by the Spirit, he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who before times were disobedient in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared. Now, it says through the Spirit, Jesus went and preached to the souls who are in prison, the spirits in prison, he says, who were disobedient in the days of Noah. Now, if Jesus went to paradise in Hades, that's not among the people who are disobedient. That'd be among the obedient. Did he go down to where the disobedient people were too? Is that what he's telling us? Or is he talking about something else? If Jesus did go down to where the disobedient were in Hades and preached to the disobedient, why would Peter limit it to the ones that were disobedient while the ark was being prepared? There's been a lot of disobedient people between the time of Noah and the time of Jesus that would have been there. Why does Peter say he went and preached to the spirits in prison who were disobedient in the days of Noah? Why single out that time? One theory, and I think this is probably a correct one, is that he's not talking about where Jesus went those 3 days that he was dead and buried. He's not even talking about Jesus preaching to people in hell at all. He's talking about the Spirit of Jesus. Remember, he says through the Spirit he preached to those who are in prison. Now, the people in question are in prison now. They've died. Their souls are now in Hades. But their time they were preached to was during the time of Noah while the ark was being built, and they were being disobedient to the preaching. And the Spirit of Christ was preaching to them through Noah. Now, that Peter would talk this way is not too strange, because two chapters earlier in 1 Peter chapter 1, in verses 10 through 12, he mentions that the prophets in the Old Testament were curious to know more about what the Spirit of Christ who was in them was telling them. But he told them it's not for them to know, but for a later generation to know, not for them. But the interesting thing is that Peter refers to the Spirit that spoke to the prophets as the Spirit of Christ. So when Peter's connecting the Holy Spirit's activity in the Old Testament through the prophets with Christ's Spirit doing it, Christ is doing this through his Spirit. So if he's thinking of Noah was preaching to the wicked while he was preparing the ark and they were disobedient, he could say that Jesus was preaching through his Spirit to them. So he's not even talking about what happened while Jesus was in the grave. He's simply saying the Spirit of Christ is the same Spirit that preached to the people before the flood, you know, through Noah. They are now dead, so their spirits are in prison now, but not then. That they were alive at the time. Now, the interesting thing is we don't have anything in the book of Genesis that tells us that these people were preached to at all. Noah in the Old Testament is never mentioned to be a preacher, just a boat builder, a righteous man who built an ark. But it never mentions in Genesis, where Noah's entire story is told, that he preached. But we do know from 2 Peter chapter 2 that Peter said that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. Okay, so Peter, who wrote 1 and 2 Peter, mentions in 2 Peter that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. I'm not sure where Peter got that information, but we know that that was in his thoughts. Noah preached these people. So when he talks about people being preached to while the ark was being prepared, there's a very good likelihood that the preaching he's thinking of was through Noah, and that it was through the Spirit that Jesus preached them through his prophet Noah. And that, in other words, if that's the meaning, and I think once we look at 1 Peter 3, verses 20 and 21, it's hard to find a different interpretation that answers to all the details of the verses better than that. It would not then be telling us anything about what Jesus did while he was in the grave. It's not even talking about that subject. And that's where people get the idea that Jesus went and preached to the people in hell. Well, if that's not what that passage is talking about, then we don't have any record at all of Jesus preaching to anyone those 3 days. So we've got a couple of problems. One is, you know, we don't know what is meant when Peter said his soul is not left in Hades. Is he, you know, is he talking about paradise preaching down there? Or is he talking about simply his body was not left in the tomb, but was risen? Peter's statement is often, you know, the one people cite the most, but it's very questionable whether that's even the subject he's talking about. And the only other passage I know of that's used is Ephesians chapter 4, where Paul refers to the fact that Jesus ascended on high, but then he kind of, by way of a, you know, commentary, says, now that he ascended on high, what is it but that he first descended to the lower parts of the earth? That's, of course, verse, what is that, 8 or so, verse 9, Ephesians 4, 9. Now, this statement, he ascended, what does it mean but that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all heavens that he might fill all things. Now, this statement that Jesus descended to the lower parts of the earth, at least when I was being raised, I was told that this means he went down to Hades during the 3 days he was dead, down to the lower parts of the earth. And you asked about what's meant by the heart of the earth. Well, Jesus did say, obviously in Matthew 12:40, that as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish or the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The heart of the earth just means, at least I think in some cases, just below the surface, not on the surface of the earth, but below the surface, in on the interior portion, not the exterior portion of the earth. So being buried could conceivably be referred to that way. When Paul says that Jesus descended to the lower parts of the earth, I always figured, I mean, I was taught that that's a reference to his being going down to Hades, you know. But I was surprised some years ago when I was reading one of the Psalms, it was Psalm 139, I believe. And it's David says, he's talking about how God, he's fearfully and wonderfully made and that God formed him. And he says, in the lower parts of the earth, in my mother's womb, basically, he refers to the time in his mother's womb as being the time when he was in the lower parts of the earth. I'm going to turn there just so I can get the actual wording. You know, in the Jewish parallelism, the two statements are equivalent to each other. Let me get it here. Okay, Psalm 139, verse 13, for you have formed my inward parts, you covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I'm fearfully, wonderfully made, marvelous are your works. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. So David, that's verses 13 through 15. David used that same expression Paul used, the lower parts of the earth or the lowest parts of the earth, as when David was wrought or framed or put together in the lowest parts of the earth, meaning in his mother's womb. The lowest parts of the earth might mean the lowest in status or rank. An infant is the lowest status in society, you know. God, Jesus is now filling all heavens. He's ascended above every name and so forth, but he first came to the lowest realms of earthly existence to be a baby in a womb. And if that's what Paul means, that is, if he's using the term the way that David used the term, it's not telling us again about Jesus going somewhere when he was dead, but simply coming to earth as a baby. The reason we talk about him ascending is because he had originally been up there and he came down and became a human, you know, but now he's gone back and ascended. So he had to first descend before he could ascend. So this is the whole biblical case. You're right. Some of the creeds say, you know, he was crucified by Pontius Pilate, died, and, you know, descended into hell and rose on the third day. This reference that he descended into hell is simply not a biblical statement. It's a creedal statement, many of the creeds. And maybe it's true. We're not really told. That could be what happened. But when, if we look for biblical authority on it, those passages I just talked about, that's the whole case. And as you can see,
okay,
all of them combined or any of them selectively, individually, might be seen that way, but certainly there are other ways to see them that are equally good. So I have to plead ignorance. You know, I don't know exactly where Jesus was. He was below the ground. But was he consciously in Hades? Could be.
Well, that's sufficient. Yeah. No, I appreciate your time and your thoughtfulness, and thank you for the opportunity. And yes, thanks again for the verses for reference.
Well, it's great to have you with us. Where are you joining us from? What part of the country?
Huntington Beach. I listened to you on the radio, and then on Facebook. I saw the link for this. So again, thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah, my pleasure having you, Steve. God bless you.
Okay, thank you. God bless.
We got another Steve. Steve Grube next. Hi, Steve.
Hi.
Hi, I remember you guys. I see Steve too. That's a big picture.
Yeah. So I have a question. I was really curious about the Herod's temple and not containing the Ark of the Covenant. And what was the veil protecting if it didn't have the Holy of Holies?
Well, it had the Holy of Holies, which is simply a room.
Yeah. Okay.
It would seem that the Holy of Holies was empty at that point in time in Herod's temple. We do not, you know, when Solomon's temple was destroyed, the furniture of the temple was carried away into Babylon. And we know it was much of that furniture was still there when Babylon fell, because Belshazzar, the last king at the time of Babylon's fall in Daniel 5, recovered some of the cups and drank from them and stuff that had been used in the temple. And there are bas reliefs in museums that show the Babylonians carrying away the furniture of the temple into Babylon. And you can see quite easily the lampstand and some of the other furniture, but there's no image of the Ark of the Covenant, or the mercy seat would have been very noticeable because it had the cherubim on top. And in fact, you'd think that was the one that the artist would most like to, you know, carve a picture of. But there's no evidence that the Ark went into Babylon. So when Zerubbabel came back, I'm sure he brought back all the furniture from Babylon that was available. Apparently the Ark was not there. Now, the Jews do not believe that the Ark went to Babylon or came back, obviously. The Jews believe that before the Babylonians destroyed the temple, that Jeremiah the prophet, apparently with some other people helping him, went into the temple and took the Ark. And when we know that Jeremiah and many Jews went down into Egypt to escape retribution from Nebuchadnezzar, and the Jews' tradition is that Jeremiah took the Ark down to Egypt and that it has never been seen since. That means, of course, that when Herod's temple was built, Zerubbabel's temple was built, it did not have the Ark. Herod's temple was just the same temple, only greatly embellished. Zerubbabel had a small budget, made a small temple. Herod had a big budget and embellished it, made it bigger and more beautiful and more like one of the seven wonders of the world. But the Ark was not there. Now, it's not impossible that they could have made a new Ark, but I don't think that this is the view that the Jews hold. And I believe the second temple, therefore, did not have the Ark in it. They had the Holy of Holies. And the Holy of Holies simply would have been empty, I guess, unless they had made some kind of other Ark or representation of the Ark to be there.
What would they be doing behind that, in that empty room? Once a year.
I do not know how they would conduct that. They might have stuck some kind of a table in there to sprinkle the blood on, or like I said, they might have made a replica of the Ark. I don't know that. Now, there are some books that I have not read that go into a lot of details about stuff like that. Alfred Edersheim's book about the life and times of Jesus the Messiah. probably talks about those things. Joachim Jeremias is a scholar who's written about the temple and its functions in the time of Christ. And lots of scholars quote from him details about how things were done, but I haven't read his book. I have his book. I just haven't read it. It's too detailed. I'm not sufficiently interested to spend the time, but there are books that would tell a lot more than I'm able to tell you about how Judaism was practiced in the Second Temple.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Steve.
All right.
Thank you, Steve.
All right. Good to have you both here. All right. Let's see here. Lidhu, welcome to the Narrow Path Zoom meeting.
Hi, Steve. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
And Steve. Yes.
Hello, everybody. My question is regarding the sacrificial system and the blood of Christ. Did he go after being resurrected and the transfiguration? Did he go into heaven with God into a temple there and sprinkle blood there?
Well, not at the transfiguration, he didn't. Some people think he did after his resurrection or at his ascension. We do know this. The book of Hebrews in chapter 9 tells us that Jesus did not enter into holy places made with hands, but into heaven itself, and not with the blood of bulls and goats, with his own blood he entered. So the imagery of the high priest going into the Holy of Holies and sprinkling animal blood on the Holy of Holies there, on the mercy seat there, is seen as a type of what Christ has done. And Christ is described as entering the Holy of Holies in heaven and taking his blood to sprinkle there in contrast to animal blood. Now, whether this is literal or not, I do not know. It's very possible. I mean, many preachers take it quite literally. And I'm not going to say it isn't literal. I don't know. It may be simply that the spiritual meaning of the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, was fulfilled in what Jesus did in going to become our intercessor before God. As the high priest was interceding for the people in the Holy of Holies, so Jesus is now in heaven making intercession for us. It may be that he's using imagery of the Yom Kippur ritual, or it may be that there's something more literal. Maybe Jesus literally did do that. I think the answer to that would be, a person would incline one way or the other, depending on how comfortable they are with non-literalness in some of the language of what goes on in heaven. For example, the visions of heaven in Revelation 4 and 5 and some other places, 15 and so forth, I personally see it as symbolic rather than literal, but it wouldn't bother me if they're literal. Some people are more inclined to take those things literally. If one is of that type, they probably would say that what is described in Hebrews chapter 9 literally did occur, that Jesus went up and sprinkled his blood on the Holy of Holies. On the mercy seat in heaven. I'm not sure that that's literal, but it's fine with me if it is. I don't think we can decide.
Well, thank you very much for answering that. And that whole transaction with, my question is, so does after the transfiguration and Jesus returning to heaven to sit at the right-hand side of God on the throne as our Messiah, was that the actual signification of the end of the sacrificial era? And thank you so much.
I think you are equating the transfiguration with the ascension, but what you mean, I think, is the ascension. And when Jesus ascended,
yes,
I do believe that his entering in the holy places brought an end to any validity or necessity of the Jewish temple system being practiced, because you don't need two atonements, one on earth and one in heaven at the same time, especially if the one on earth is being performed by someone who doesn't believe in Christ, which was the high priest. So I think the Jewish temple system was obsolete as soon as Jesus went up there. And I think that's what the writer of Hebrews is implying too. Thank you very much. Paula.
Yeah. Hi, Steve. if I can double back to the earlier question, I probably would not be inclined to go to the wedding that Beg referred to, but does it make any difference whether the person getting married professes to be a Christian or not?
Well, you know, if a person professes to be a Christian and they're entering into a sinful wedding,
right, then obviously you wouldn't condone it.
You couldn't condone it. And in fact, that's a situation where Paul in 1 Corinthians 5 might say you shouldn't even eat with such a person. Remember, he says, we don't judge those who are outside the church, but those who are inside the church, we need to. And he says, if we're to judge those outside the church, we'd have to leave the world. We can't avoid all the sinners in the world, but he says, right, if he claims to be a brother or a sister and is a fornicator or whatever, he says, don't even eat one with one like that. So that's a hard word. It's a hard saying, but I think that them being a Christian would make it even more applicable to the church discipline.
My question is, the grandmother obviously was a Christian, but I'm thinking maybe the grandchild wasn't. Right. So whether that, I probably wouldn't go, although when we were first married, we went to my brother-in-law's second marriage when there really weren't grounds for a divorce and remarriage.
Yeah.
Because we hadn't thought about all this stuff yet.
Right.
That didn't come up until we got into Mennonite circles. But I'm wondering if there's any difference if you're trying to be a witness to an unsaved grandchild. And I'm not looking for an excuse. That question just came up to me. That's all.
Right. You know, I'm going to grant liberty of conscience. Like mm-hmm. I said, for me, going to a wedding means something very specific.
Mm-hmm.
To many in our culture, going to a wedding isn't. It does mean that. You're just a spectator of something that's happening. Mm-hmm. Your friends are doing something and, you know, they invite you to watch. It's, you know, to me, marriage is a very sacred thing. It's a very important thing like that. Obviously, with many people who are getting married, they don't see it that way. And and your attendance there would be almost like going to any other kind of event, any kind of secular events, you know, which I don't. Yeah, I'm not going to make rules for people about that. But my advice would be not to do so. If someone did so, and simply said, listen, my coming here is not registering my approval, I'm sorry to say, I'd like to stay on your good side. And I would also, in not going, I'd want to communicate to them to this. My not going to your wedding, I know makes you feel uncomfortable and makes me seem like the bad guy. But you have to understand, you getting married like this makes me uncomfortable. Now, who's being the bad guy? The one who makes you uncomfortable or the one who makes me uncomfortable? I mean, why would I have more obligation to make sure you're comfortable with my actions?
Mm-hmm.
I have an obligation to make me comfortable with yours. You know, the truth is, you have your convictions and I have mine. And you shouldn't think badly of me for following mine, because you're apparently following yours. And if you don't think I have as much right to my convictions as you have to yours, then we live in different worlds, because I think...
That's a good point.
You know, I think I have as much right to follow my beliefs as you have to follow yours.
Yeah, I only thought of that question because it wasn't clear in what was reported in the media. So that kind of raised the question. But yeah, I don't think at this point in life, certainly, I don't think I would feel comfortable doing it. Thanks a lot. And say hi to Dana.
All right. We'll do.
Thanks. Bye.
Thank you, Paula. Abram, we've come all the way around to you now.
Thank you very much. Oh, it's a very enjoyable evening here tonight. You listened to all of the questions and all the responses.
A little late for you.
It definitely. It's a real treat. Yeah. A couple of things. 1 Corinthians 15:45 and Genesis 2, verse 7, the concept of a living soul. It's popular to think that Adam and Eve were created immortal. Would you speak a little bit to that, and you give us your wisdom on whether or not that's true?
Well, of course, in Genesis, it says that God made man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the spirit or the breath of life, the ruach, and man became a living nefesh, a living soul. And then in 1 Corinthians 15, of course, Paul says, it is written that man the first man, Adam, became a living soul, and the second man, Adam, became a life-giving spirit. The statement in 1 Corinthians 15 is actually considerably harder to exegete than the one in Genesis. But when we say, well, man was made a soul, therefore he's made immortal. Not necessarily. The animals were made souls too in the Genesis account, and especially of the flood. It talks about every living soul, every living nephesh is going to die, meaning of the animals, everything that has breath of life in them. So nephesh, or what's translated soul, is also translated as creature in Genesis, depending on whether it's talking about animals or people. Therefore, unless we believe that animals are immortal, the word soul, nephesh, doesn't imply in itself immortality. Now, my understanding, and this is different than many other people's understanding about this, so it's just something people could disagree about. I believe that Adam and Eve were souls, to be sure. And I believe they also possessed an element of their nature that the animals don't possess, which might be called their spirit, or might even have been morphed into the psuche, soul in the Greek, in the New Testament, but it's the non-material aspect of the person in addition to their body. And I believe that that's what is at home in the body when we're alive, and absent from the body when we die and present with the Lord. There's something of us that isn't our body that can be in or out of our body, can be absent or present in the body. So we have a non-material side too, and this is sometimes called the soul or the spirit in the New Testament. I think even the Old Testament sometimes uses the word nephesh that way, so it's got a breadth of meaning. But soul doesn't itself mean an immortal soul. I mean, I think in almost all dialogue theologically, people talk, well, man has an immortal soul. Well, the word immortal doesn't have to attach to the word soul. Man has a soul. Man is a soul. If he's immortal or not is a separate question. It looks to me like Adam and Eve were not created immortal, but they were created conditionally, potentially immortal. If they would eat of the tree of life, they would live forever. And that was therefore the condition for becoming immortal. But I think from the moment they were created, they were like other animals. They were alive, but not immortal. But unlike the animals, they had the privilege of becoming immortal by eating of that tree, unless they would eat the wrong tree, in which case they would be cut off from that and they'd continue to be mortal. So that's kind of how I understand that. I don't see the word soul in our English translations as implying immortality necessarily.
But real quick, unrelated, something was said earlier towards the beginning of your broadcast about this Zoom meeting be available as a rebroadcast on YouTube. Did I understand that correctly, or am I mistaken?
That's correct. I don't know if Tim's still with us here. It's very late where he is, but same time as what it is where you are, I guess. But he also runs our YouTube channel, and so he takes these meetings each month, and I don't know how it's done because I don't do it, but he posts it at the YouTube channel.
Well, I've seen like outtakes or something, like a specific question or something that's posed that gets a video treatment or something.
Yeah, those are found there too. There's quite a variety of YouTube things at that channel, and almost always Tim, once he posts something new at the YouTube channel that wasn't there before, he will post an announcement about it on the Facebook page. I don't know if you go to our Facebook page or not, but it's...
Yes, I don't have Facebook, but I probably should, just for the sake of being able to go to the Facebook page. One more sidebar thing. I want you to get to your other questions tonight, and I want to be courteous to other people who've been patiently waiting. Eric Metaxas has this new film out. You probably heard of it, this Letter to the American Church. I'm kind of interested in seeing it. I know it's going to be broadcast in a select group of theaters here. I guess it's based on a book by him or something. And I know it's political. I don't even know why really I'm mentioning this. But Marion and I are interested in, we're either going to get the film and watch it, or because it's not coming to anywhere near our neck of the woods. But something about if the church does nothing, then the church could be, subject to
tyrants,
totalitarian takeover and all that. And it's, I guess, from what I understand, it's kind of like a an urging for the American church to kind of be more active in a political process. Anyway, I'll let you know about that. I'm going to go. I'm going to shut up and let other people ask some questions because I love you and I love my brothers and sisters who are here tonight. So thank you so much for the time.
Okay, God bless you. Say hi to Marion for me.
Yeah, I will. And yeah, I'm just going to listen now.
All right, great. And I'm going to talk next to my other friend, Buzz.
Hello, Steve.
How you doing, brother?
Things are good up in Chico. A little bit of flooding, not as much.
You know, I was up in your neck of the woods. I was up in Sacramento recently, and I didn't go up to Chico.
I would have liked to come down there, but I had a little minor surgery situation on getting over. But
sorry.
Anyway, good to see you. And I had a comment, if it's okay, would relate to Dale and his wife's question about the land promise.
Uh-huh.
You know, since the Hamas war with Israel, there's been, you know, revival of dispensational talk. And I've been surprised to hear both John MacArthur and another prominent Calvary Chapel teacher talk about the extent of the land promise, that it was originally a lot larger, far greater land area than Israel occupied back in the Old Testament times, and it would go back to, they would go back to Genesis 15, 18, where God made the promise to Abraham that to his descendants, I've given the land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. And these teachers are saying that the river of Egypt is the Nile River, and the river Euphrates, they are, you know, it's easy to think this way, that the river Euphrates would take us over to present day Iraq. But I was doing a little research on that. And first of all, the idea of the river of Egypt is actually in other scriptural references referred to as the Brook of Egypt.
Yeah.
Which is also called in some cases the Wadi al-Arash, which is just south of Gaza.
That's right.
And so that would be part of the southern boundary area. And if,
yeah, the Nile doesn't create a southern boundary. It runs north-south.
Right. You know? And then also that it would go over to present-day Iraq and also include part of Saudi Arabia, they're saying. But, you know, it's easy to imagine when you think of the Euphrates River going over to present-day Iraq, that actually the Euphrates headwaters up in southeastern Turkey and comes through northern Syria, and that is the northern boundary. And in Numbers chapter 34, there's this very detailed description of the boundaries. And of course, the Jordan River is the eastern boundary, and then it extends north through the Sea of Galilee and all the way up north. In Numbers 34, it doesn't mention the Euphrates, but it does mention areas up there in some places that are not known to us today, but which would be up where the present, where the ancient city of Carchemish was. And so anyway, that was just, I just wanted to throw that in. I don't know if anybody's hearing that, but it was surprising to me to hear that they're saying that they are still yet to possess the land all the way over.
That's commonly said by dispensationalists. They say they never possess the land up as far as the Euphrates, which is supposed to be the northern boundary. Well, there is a verse that they should pay more attention to. In 1 Kings chapter 4, it's talking about Solomon's kingdom that he reigned over, which was the kingdom of Israel, but it talks about the boundaries. In 1 Kings 4:21, it says, so Solomon reigned over all the kingdoms from the river Euphrates to the land of the Philistines, as far as the border of Egypt. They brought tribute and served Solomon all the days of his life. So part of the Israel's empire extended up to the river Euphrates and down to the border of Egypt. And of course, you know, those are the north and south regions. So, you know, if the king of Israel was ruling over a region that included up to the river Euphrates, that sounds like God gave him the land up to that point.
Right. And then, of course, you have Joshua 21 that you quote from, too, yeah, that says that they received all the land. But it was surprising to me to even hear John MacArthur say that the River of Egypt was the Nile River. And I accidentally have his study Bible, by accident. And I looked up Genesis 15:18 in his study Bible, and the notes there, it actually says the River of Egypt is the Brook of Egypt, the Wadi al-Arash. So John MacArthur needs to look at his own study Bible, I think, too. Just one other quick mention in regards to this. Just before Babylon took Judah into captivity, Egypt apparently controlled that land that you referenced, where King David and Solomon reigned over. And the king of Babylon, it says in 2 Kings 24, verse 7, that the king of Egypt did not come out of the land anymore, for the king of Babylon had taken all that belonged to the king of Egypt, from the brook of Egypt to the river Euphrates. Mm. So there's that territory is mentioned again. And if the land extended all the way over to present-day Iraq, Abraham never would have had to have left Haran to go into the promised land, or Moses would have never had to take the children of Israel out of Egypt because they were already there at the Nile River. It's just ridiculous. So thanks for letting me share that. And I hope maybe that might have been of interest to Dale. And I forgot your wife's name, Dale, but nice having you here with us today.
And thank you, Buzz. I'm glad you're recovering from your, what surgery did you have?
It was a hernia surgery.
Yes. I have a friend who had a hernia surgery last week, and he is.
Yeah, right. Well, I'm about 4 weeks along and going fine. I just can't lift anything over 10 pounds for another couple of weeks. I'm playing it for all it's worth.
Yes, appreciate it. All right, Buzz. Well, good talking to you. I'm glad you've got it. Thanks.
Thank you, Buzz.
Austin, welcome to the Zoom meeting.
Hey, good to be with you again. Grace and peace to you all. I want to try to make this somewhat quick. I can see Max is on. I have been just going down just a hole with Calvinism and Arminianism. I know you are not a Calvinist. Are you an Arminianist? I never did catch on to that.
Well, you don't have to be one or the other. Arminianism, you know, has its own views that are different than Calvinism, but are also not the only alternatives. I would call myself an Arminian if somebody says, are you Calvinist or Arminian? Because Calvinists refer to any non-Calvinist as an Arminian. So in that umbrella term, I would go ahead and use it. But if somebody wants me to give a description of my views, I won't describe myself as Arminian, but rather non-Calvinist.
I've caught that a bunch of times. Okay. So I've listened to, I guess, the God's sovereignty and man's salvation. I've used the archives to go through a lot of things. Tonight's teaching was on the Holy Spirit. And one question that was asked was, one statement that was made was, the Holy Spirit enters into your life when you surrender your life to Jesus. And then a question to that was asked, can the Holy Spirit be doing a work on us prior to leading to belief? A point that was made from 2 Corinthians was that minds were hardened through, that through Christ, that Christ has to take off. This point was made that, like, there were those that cannot receive the gospel unless Christ reveals them to be able to receive it. So what are your thoughts on all of this?
Well, I do believe that people don't become Christians without a prior working of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus said, no man can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, I believe that that drawing to Christ is the Holy Spirit's drawing. Now, the word draw, Calvinists say that word means to drag, you know, like irresistibly. That word does not mean that. The word is used in Scripture other ways besides that. In fact, in Hosea chapter 11, in the Greek Septuagint, that very word is used where God says that he drew Israel out of Egypt, but then they went away. They went astray from him, you know, as he was drawing them. So you don't have to, it's not an irresistible drawing. So, and Jesus said, if I'm lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself in John chapter 12, same word in the Greek. And obviously not all men come to him. So there is, you know, there's some invalidity in the claim that drawing is irresistible. But I do believe God draws, but not irresistibly. I believe that a person will not become a Christian if God doesn't first convict them. And that's the Holy Spirit's work upon them, convicting. Jesus said in John 16, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, will convict the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. And I think that conviction is what eventually leads people to come to Christ if they do. I believe the Holy Spirit can convict them, and they won't. You know, it's interesting that it says in Acts chapter 2, when Peter preached, the people's hearts were cut, they were cut to the heart. I believe they're convicted by the Holy Spirit, and they said, what must we do? And many of them got healed. But in chapter 7, when Stephen preached to the Sanhedrin, it says they were cut to the heart and they killed him. You know, they felt convicted, but conviction doesn't always result in the same response. Some people get angry and hate the messenger when they're convicted, and others convert. That's really a choice we have. So I believe, of course, Calvinism teaches that you can't become a Christian unless God irresistibly draws you. I would say you probably can't become a Christian unless the Spirit at least convicts you. But once you're convicted, you're not irresistibly drawn. You still have free will.
Oh, that's a very good point. One last one is Ephesians 2. It talks about, you know, we're saved through faith and it is a gift from God. It's always talked about that faith is a gift. What would you say to a little bit of this passage?
It does not say that faith is a gift. It says, by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Now, what he says, that is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. What is? Now they say, well, he's saying faith is, because faith is the last noun before the pronoun that. So, I mean, it's the antecedent. But the problem here is, in the Greek language, there is gender and number that a pronoun has that has to agree with the gender and number of the noun that that's its antecedent. And so both grace and faith are feminine nouns. And therefore, if Paul is talking about either grace or faith as the gift of God, then the word that would have been in the feminine form in the Greek. It's not. It's in the neuter form. And yet none of the nouns in the sentence are neuter. And so I think the most reasonable way to understand that is that that means salvation itself. By grace you've been saved through faith. And that salvation, which isn't any of the words in the passage, but just the very phenomenon of being saved, that is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Now that would make sense, because Paul and other writers of the Bible make it very clear that we're not saved simply by works. We're saved by the mercy of God, especially Paul makes this point. It's salvation is not of works. And Paul has to emphasize that, because many people by nature think that salvation would be by works. But no one I know thinks that faith comes as a result of works. So why would he say faith? Well, that's not of works. That's, you know, well, wait a minute, whoever suggested that faith was of works? You know, having faith is just a choice you make to believe or not believe. But many people would think that salvation is of works. So when he says that is not of oneself, it's not of works, it's a gift of God. He's not talking about faith or grace. He's talking about salvation itself.
Very good. Well, I sure do appreciate it. And appreciate all of your ministry and just that platform to be able to go back and, you know, have the archives of the verse by verse and topical. It fills my day. I feel like I spend a lot of time with you.
Well, thanks, Austin. I'm glad you're there. Thanks for joining us.
Yes, sir.
All right, Max, how are you doing?
Good, Steve. It's Max the Atheist out of Portland. How are you?
I assumed it. Oh, you look a lot different than I thought.
Well, I hope you can't see me. I hope I just have this cityscape of Portland up.
I know I can't see, but I do know what you look like.
Thank goodness. Rather than a question of logic, I have more of a question of logistics, and that is our debate. I've been emailing, well, the three of us have been sort of corresponding back and forth via email with the hosts on Modern Day Debates. I just wanted to ask if I can promote here on tonight's Zoom, given that it would be February. It'd be February 24th, which is a Saturday at 5 p.m. Pacific. Does that date work for you?
That works for me, I think. The 24th, I write it down here. 5 p.m. Okay.
5 p.m. Pacific, February 24th. And I know you wanted a debate topic. And the thing about the debate topic is they sort of need it to be clickbait, sort of, for the YouTube. It needs to just be short and sweet. So he's the debate moderator suggested, is Christianity true? As the debate topic.
Yeah, that works for me.
Is perfect.
Perfect. Yeah.
And as far as I know, it'll be a lot like this, just like over Zoom. And then the moderator will handle the technical aspect of putting our Zooms together so we can see each other, and then be live streamed, as it were, on YouTube on Saturday, February 24th at 5 p.m. Pacific.
Cool. Excellent. Now, why don't you, when you have the information, give me the logon information so I can log on, and also maybe if there's a live stream link so that we can post that on Facebook, people can watch it live.
Yep. I think we just needed to narrow down the commitment from you so that we could actually just be sure that we got the link, and they'll probably ask you for like a picture for a thumbnail and all that good stuff. So
I don't think
just check your email.
I don't think that's a draw. Okay. We're good. We're good. Yeah, that'll be fine.
Hey, good deal. Yeah. Enjoying the Zoom tonight too. So I'll stick around for the rest of it. Thanks so much, Steve. I'm sure maybe if I don't talk to you then, I'm sure I'll call in to help promote too. So thanks so much.
Hey, thanks. Good to hear from you. Have a good night.
Steve.
Is that you, Tim? Yeah.
Yeah, I've been with you all through the program. I'll never leave you or forsake you. And the next meeting is March 6th, which is a Wednesday. And I think that our friend Michael will be back by then. Appreciate everybody's input. If you would please close us in prayer, Steve. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity. And I pray you'll bless it and let each one meditate on the things that of importance that have been said or inquired about, and give wisdom to them beyond anything that I've been able to bring up. Just we pray you, by your Spirit, lead us all into a full understanding of your truth. I do pray for Alistair Begg and this controversy. I pray that that things will be cleared up in a way that glorifies you, Father. And it is necessary for us to have your wisdom about these decisions. I pray that you'll guide your people who are put in that position to have to either do something or counsel someone else in such a situation. I pray that you'll give us your wisdom so that we live lives pleasing to you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, then. Great talking to y'all.
Amen.
Good night.